Hi, today we're going to be going over how to use the Lambda GPU Cloud. First step, go to lambdalabs.com. Then click on GPU Cloud. Then click the Sign Up Now button, input an email, and confirm your password to create your account. You'll simply click Sign Up for free. You won't be charged anything until you spin up an instance. Put in your credit card information for billing purposes, and then you'll be brought to the dashboard page. I'm going to log in directly now. This is the new instance dashboard. As you can see, there's no instances running now, but we're going to spin one up. So click Launch Instance. This prompts you to paste in your public key. You can either paste in your public key and name it, or if you'd like to create one right now, you can click I don't have an SSH key. So I'm going to name this key Test Key GPU. And I'm going to hit Create. You'll be prompted to download this PEM file, and the PEM file is your, you can think of it like your password to the instance. And now you can see it's asking which SSH key should we use. So I'm going to select this Test Key GPU and then click Launch, and that's going to spin up an instance. At first, you're not going to see much. It's going to be launching while it creates the virtual machine. In a short while, you're going to see the virtual machine has been created, but an IP address is yet to be assigned to it. Within the next 10 to 15 seconds, you'll see that an IP address has indeed been assigned and will be ready to SSH into the instance. So what I'm going to do is grab my private key and then copy this SSH Ubuntu. I'm just going to copy this login thing, and we're going to use that to access the instance. So I'm going to go over to a terminal, and we're going to log in. All right. So first thing you're going to want to do is change the permission on the downloaded test key that you have. So I'm doing chmod 600 downloads test key. We can also move that into, you can move that into your SSH folder if you'd like this, but that's not necessary. So what we're going to do is we're going to SSH into this instance using that private key. So you'll note that I'm doing SSH and then dash I, a path to the private key that we downloaded, Ubuntu at this IP address. So we're going to hit enter. So you're going to be prompted, are you sure you want to continue? Answer yes, because this is your first time logging into a host at that IP address. Voila, you now have access to your instance. So what we're going to do just to play around here is we're going to do some basic matrix multiplication jobs on the GPU. So first I'm going to use tmux, which is already installed, to do some terminal multiplexing. So what we're going to do is we're going to show htop in one corner. We're going to watch NVIDIA SMI in the other corner. And then here we're going to use Python and Torch to do some matrix multiplication jobs. So first we're going to do something that's a 25,000 by 25,000 square matrix. We're going to import Torch. And then we're going to do loop forever on doing a matrix multiplication of a random matrix of 25,000 squared. And we're going to do .cuda to put it onto the GPU. And we're going to call this forever, and you're going to see what's going to happen. So you're going to see that the GPU here in the bottom right is going to start being utilized. You can see the memory is climbing on that. You're getting a little bit of GPU utilization there. And you're going to start to see that the instance is doing the calculations that we're expecting. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to kill this job, and we're going to sort of explore some of the other things you can do with the instance. So another thing that you can do is you can use TensorFlow. So we can import TensorFlow. We can use Cafe. Oh, you know what, I think that I should probably kill this process. All right, so you can see we can use TensorFlow. And we can also use Cafe. So you'll see that I ran into a little bit of a bug, which is that you can't really import TensorFlow and Torch at the same time. That's sort of a known issue, and that's just something that would be the same for any bare metal instance or any virtualized instance as well. The other thing you can do here is that you can write a Jupyter Notebook. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a virtual environment to run a Jupyter Notebook and we're going to access that Jupyter Notebook from the web browser. So the first step there is to do Python 3mvim Jupyter. And you'll see, we got to install Python 3 venv. So do sudo apt-get install Python 3 venv. And that's going to download the Python 3 virtual environment tool, which we can then use. Now that it's been created, I'm just going to jpr bin activate to get into that Python virtual environment. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to do pip install Jupyter. J-U-P-Y-T-E-R. And I'm also going to do pip install TensorFlow within this virtual environment. So pip install TensorFlow-GPU. We may need to use an older version of TensorFlow. I'm about to find out very shortly. So while that's downloading, you'll see that we've got very fast internet connection. We've got a another nice thing is that we have very fast instance-to-instance connections, which you can use for distributed training with tools like Horovod or TensorFlow. So while that's building, let me quickly put together the... Oh, there it is. Okay. So first, let's make sure that we can import TensorFlow. Okay, so no. Unfortunately, this is requiring TensorFlow, CUDA 10. So we do pip uninstall TensorFlow GPU. And we're just going to pin this at 1.12 instead of 1.13. Yep. Okay. And you can see that the CUDA version here is 9. And so we're going to stick with TensorFlow 1.12. All right, so now that's a version that's been compiled with CUDA 9 support. So we're going to let that build. It's going to take a little bit of time. All right, now that that's done, let's just quickly verify that we can import TensorFlow. Beautiful, that works perfectly. Okay, so now that we've got Jupyter installed and TensorFlow installed, let's just run Jupyter Notebook, enter. And so now it's saying, okay, right, to access this notebook, open this file. You can see this is running on localhost. What we really want to do is not run it on localhost, but is run it on 0.0.0.0. So what we're going to want to do there is set the IP to 0.0.0.0. so that it can run on the public. All right, great. So now you can see it says, or copy and paste one of these URLs. So we're going to copy this URL with the token. And we're going to go over to this Firefox browser here. And we're going to paste that in. So I'm just going to paste that in. So now it's asking, it's saying 96-76. You need to change that to the public IP address of the instance, and hit enter. There we go. We've got our Jupyter notebook running, and we should be able to upload files this way. We can upload files. We can create a new Python 3 notebook. We can open up a terminal. And so now we can do things like import TensorFlow, s equals TensorFlow.session, and you'll see that we're running on the GPU, and that we can actually run this code here. So that's a basic way to get Jupyter notebooks all set up. Note that you are going to want to, after you're done using this, you know you're going to want to kind of copy back your notebook using the scp command. So let me just show you quickly how I can do that. So I'm just going to save this notebook. So you just do, you know, click the save icon or click file save as, and save that. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go back to the terminal here, and we're going to copy this file back home. So I'm going to go into my make a tempter. Actually, I'm just going to okay, and I'm going to remember how we first accessed this machine. So I'm going to kill this. So let's say you've got either your IPython notebook, or you've got you've got some other data or a code file. Let's say we've got foo.py. I'll just do hello, this is a file. Okay, so we're going to create some file, foo.py, and you can see that's inside this home directory. We're then going to go over to this tab right here, and we're going to copy that over. So if you remember, this was my command that I used to SSH into the instance. We're just going to change it to SCP, and we're going to do, you know, let's just copy over foo.py. Okay, so we've copied foo.py. Let's also copy over our any, I think it was called Untitled. How do you do that again? Untitled. Let's just do star. Why not? So that's going to copy over foo.py, and then the Untitled Notebook. It's not happy about copying over that folder, but we're not wanting that anyways. And so we've got a IPython notebook file here too now. All right, great. So that's how you kind of copy things back and forth. You know, you just reverse that command, so you do, you know, we can copy something up here, so I can create a local file, so. So we can, that should be okay, though. Oh, I see. Okay, so we're just gonna copy this big chunk of random data up to the server. There you go. And we can also now, if we SSH back in there, we'll be able to see that there's now random.txt right there. Very cool. Okay, so now what we're going to do is terminate the instance. So we don't need anything else here, you know. We can just sort of terminate the instance. I just want to quickly check something here. You know, oops, I got the wrong token. Always remember to copy your tokens. And, you know, you can do things like download as. You can download this as a PDF. You can download it however you want without having to use SCP. And sometimes that's just a little bit easier. Oh, it looks like it doesn't have Zlog text, so I can't do a PDF export, so. But, you know, the point is that you're going to be able to do a lot of different things in terms of how you want to export this, and you don't necessarily need to use SCP. So now that you've done that, I think that it's time for us to shut down the instance. So we're going to say goodbye because we've downloaded everything that we need from the instance. And so let me just change this scene back. Yeah, again, like I was saying, I think that I didn't maybe have the scene up properly, but you can download directly from Jupyter without using SCP. So what we're going to do is just terminate the instance. So select the instance and click terminate. We're just going to type erase data on instance to confirm, because I don't want anyone deleting data without them realizing that when they terminate the instance, all of the data that was on that instance does get deleted because it is ephemeral storage and not permanent storage. Okay, so you can hit OK. And so you'll see that very shortly on my terminal over here, we're about to get kicked off, and the instance will sort of hang up here until eventually that SSH connection is terminated. And if we go back to Firefox, you'll see that it is in the process of terminating the instance, and now you can see that there's no more GPU servers running. So that is the sort of process of both starting an instance, signing up, doing a little bit of TensorFlow and PyTorch stuff, doing a little bit of Jupyter Notebook work, and then also just sort of downloading and copying data up and down from your local machine to the instance, which is really useful, obviously, for transferring data and transferring finished trained models. You can also, of course, upload that to other services like Dropbox or S3 if you want to use those command line tools. And then, so you can go over on the this dashboard page, you can click on keys, and you can see all the different public keys that you've got access to. You can click on billing to sort of see the number of hours that you've occurred over the time. Right now, this is the pricing. So it's on-demand hourly pricing of $3.20 per hour. If you'd like to sort of use the instances a lot more and you want to save some money, you can contact us, and we can set you up with a one-year reserved hourly pricing, and that's about half the cost. So if you're a heavy user, you should definitely consider that. you can see a little bit more on the frequently asked questions page, which talks a little bit about how do these instances compare versus an AWS instance. In this case, the Lambda GPU Cloud GPU 4Xs, which have four GPUs, are about half the cost of a normal AWS instance. And then even less if you do a 1-year reserved contract with us, which gives you an effective hourly rate of about 45 cents per hour per GPU, which is about, you know, compared to a P3 instance, you know, significantly less, you know, six times less expensive. Some other people might ask, well, how do you do node-to-node communication? How quick is that? Well, all the instances are networked with 10 gigabit per second Ethernet. We don't guarantee that you're going to get that peak speed all the time because there may be some congestion sometimes, but it is definitely up to 10 Gbps node-to-node communication, which is really nice. And you get pretty much linear scaling with most jobs like DenseNet and ResNet 50 and Inception 3 for distributed multi-node training. And you can see each of these bars here on this graph are 1, 2, 3, and 4 nodes. So that's between 4 and 16 GPUs. If you've got any additional questions for us or, sort of want to learn more, you can just, again, just go to lambdalabs.com/cloud. And we do have access to the, frequently asked questions page. So you just go to lambdalabs.com/service/GPU-cloud, and you can then click on that Lambda GPU Cloud frequently asked questions page. And that will answer most of your questions. Then once you're done there, you can just, start an account and start an instance. So really looking forward to seeing what you do with it, and let us know if you've got any questions. We're here to help. You can also, if you sort of want some more immediate help, you can click this sort of intercom icon here and start a new conversation. Say, hey, I need help with the GPU cloud, with the Lambda GPU cloud. And somebody will help you. All right, cool. Thanks a lot, and looking forward to what you can do with the Lambda GPU Cloud instances.